is Dale Gallipo. I'm arguing on behalf of the appellants and the plaintiffs, and I want to thank all of you for accommodating my schedule. It's very much appreciated. I'm hoping to save 5 minutes, but we'll see how that goes. In short, in reviewing the district court's decision, because we have a motion for summary judgment, we believe this court is looking at it de novo. And importantly, from our perspective, we believe all the facts presented by the plaintiff need to be assumed to be true by the court. Maybe more importantly, all reasonable inferences from those facts should be decided in the plaintiff's favor.
Can you help me out with something on this case? And I know you attack it, but I ask you this question. Can you explain to me the basis for excluding some version of the video from consideration? I've looked, and I suspect I speak for my colleagues, but they can speak for themselves. I've looked at the videos. They seem to, they surely depict the incident that is the subject of this litigation. What do you understand the judge's basis for excluding the video was? Put aside whether it's the enhanced video or the original one for a second.
It's somewhat unclear from our perspective. The unenhanced video we received in discovery from the defendant.
Yeah, I don't think there's any there may be a dispute about whether you properly authenticated the enhanced one, but just focus on the unenhanced.
And the enhanced, quite frankly, I don't see any significant difference. There might have been some attempt.
Well, but there is an argument that you never presented evidence about authenticating how it was
passed. Yes.
But focus on the unenhanced one for a second.
Yes.
Because, and let me tell you what, and I'm going to ask your colleague the same question, your opponent the same question. The judge's rulings all seem to stem from, I have a video which I don't think is admissible evidence, and therefore the expert reports are fluid because they relied on the video or flowed from the video. So I'm trying to understand, tell me why you think, maybe the better question is, tell me why you think the video, the unenhanced video, was admissible.
Well, because first of all, there was no objection to it, the unenhanced video, at any time. Second of all, it was supplied to us by the defense for purposes of discovery. It's not something that we created. Third of all, as I think you've already pointed out, I think it unarguably shows the event, which I think is a very important piece of evidence because we believe it specifically contradicts the officer's version of the events.
So now you've led me to my next question, so I thank you for that. Let's assume it is admissible. I've looked at it. It doesn't clearly depict what was happening between the time Mr. Newmaker was taken behind the police vehicle and the time that they came out. How does it create a triable issue of fact, in your view, on the issue of immunity?
Because we believe that, like all evidence, the court should take all reasonable inferences in our favor. We believe the evidence, along with other evidence of the video, establishes that both shots occurred after he went to the ground. This is important for several reasons. One reason, if you carefully look at the video, that you can tell that is because the shooting officer did not pull his gun out until after he went to the ground. We've had the benefit, of course, of stopping it as we proceed. There's a time sequence on the video, and for example, at 6 hours and 16 minutes and 43 seconds, 6:16:43, the people first come into view on the video. From 6:16:51 to 59, you see 4 or 5 baton strikes. At 6:17 and 23 seconds, they first go behind the car. And at 6:17 and 30 to 31 seconds, Officer Solt goes to get his baton. He left his baton, and then he went to grab it. At 6:17 and 37 seconds, you see a baton strike by Officer Solt behind the vehicle. Now, here's where it gets important. At 6:17...
Stop for a second there. You say at that point you see a baton strike behind the vehicle.
Yes, and honestly, yes.
Explain, I've looked at the video, and So without arguing with you about what it shows, tell me what you think it shows.
If you look carefully at it, you will see the raising of a baton and the arm of Officer Solt coming down towards the decedent. If you carefully look at it at 617 and
30. 36 and 37?
Yes. Now, this is really important because at 617, 40, and 41, you see Mr. Newmaker going to the ground. You see his hands come into view.
And he's now on the other side of the car.
Correct.
Okay.
And you see his hands very briefly come into view with nothing in his hands. And if you stop it right there, you'll see that the shooting officer hasn't taken his gun out yet. And we feel this is very important. It's at 6:17 and 42 seconds that the shooting officer takes out his gun. He then gets in a shooting position and fires the first shot at 6:17 and 44 seconds. You can see the muzzle flash and the reaction of the decedent, which of course is consistent with the two shots to the lower back, both with a 30-degree upward trajectory, which is consistent, obviously, with the decedent leading significantly forward away from the shooter.
And also consistent with your forensic pathologist's report.
Yes, Your Honor. And also important, at 6:17 and 43 seconds, this is 1 second before the first shot, the decedent's right hand temporarily, momentarily comes into view. This is the hand they say the baton was in, and there's nothing in it. So we believe, and it should also be noted, and we noted this in our briefing, that I deposed both the defense experts, and Mr. Cameron and another gentleman, Mr. Schott. Both of them agreed in depositions that both shots happened after the decedent went to the ground.
Can I interrupt you for just a minute? I don't see those depositions anywhere in the materials that I have. Why not?
You're correct, Your Honor, because what happened, unfortunately, is the depositions were taken very shortly before the opposition was due, maybe a few days, and we did not have those transcripts. In hindsight, I should have had those transcripts.
Okay, that answers the question, because I couldn't find them. Okay.
But I would point out that the other side never said that's untrue. They never said in their pleadings. But, yes, I apologize for that. Now, what else is very important from our perspective is Officer Sergeant Hellebrick said that he never saw the decedent swing the baton on the ground. In fact, Soth, in one of his part of his deposition testimony, said he didn't swing it. There's a witness, of course, that is questionable because it's really a hearsay statement that was considered, but the witness never saw a weapon in his hands. Importantly, from our perspective, is the baton ended up on the other side of the street. Solt's explanation was Ellebrecht moved it there. Ellebrecht says in his deposition testimony, I don't recall ever touching it or ever moving the baton.
Let me ask you a question about your police practices expert. Trying to figure out what everybody agrees, and I think everybody should agree, that if Mr. Newmaker had a baton that was about to hit Officer Albert over the head with it, that violent force would be okay. And I think everybody agrees that if he was lying down on the ground and shot in the back, it wouldn't be. So of what relevance is your police practices expert in this case?
Well, what he did do is, obviously, I agree with you. Obviously, in any case, it depends on the facts. If the use of deadly force is appropriate.
I understand your forensic pathologist.
But I think what he did do, and I think it's even cited in part in the court's opinion, is that he laid out some of the post standards, the police officer standards and training that deal with use of deadly force. And he mentioned, you may recall this, that in the court even cited it, that deadly force is a last resort, only to be used in an immediate defense of life situation, and a warning should be given that you're going to use deadly force when feasible.
Yeah, but you don't contest, let's assume the only evidence in this case was that the decedent was about to bring it down in the head of Officer Hellebrecht. You don't dispute that under those circumstances, deadly force would be appropriate, do you?
Generally, no. However, what I think is important to keep in mind in this case is based on the chronology,
Well, they may have blundered their way into this situation. But I don't think that, does that make a difference?
But even slightly more than that, Your Honor, as you recall, the decedent was pepper sprayed in the face a second before he went to the ground. And what I think, one reasonable interpretation of the evidence, I believe, is when Officer Soth grabbed the baton, the decedent may have had the impression he's going to be struck again. And maybe his natural reaction was to put his hand or hands out. And at about that time, he was pepper sprayed. I even think you see Officer Soth moving his head away because I believe he didn't want to be caught with the pepper spray, and he let go of that baton. And so in that 1 second in between him being pepper sprayed and going to the ground, it's a different type of case. But yes, if you're saying if he was within his faculties and he's standing up and swinging a baton at an officer's head where the officer's about to be struck, then I would agree under those facts, if those facts were undisputed.
I'm not sure it makes a big difference in this case, but I was just, when I looked at the testimony, it was quite naturally that one doesn't use deadly force until it's a last resort. But
right.
If your fellow officer was about to be clubbed over the head with a baton, that would be appropriate circumstance.
I think something else that's important here is Sergeant Ellebrecht never pulled his gun out and said that at the time of the shots, he was 6 feet away, certainly by the time of the second shot. And in fact, Officer Soth says he didn't even know where Sergeant Ellebrecht was at the time of the second shot. And so we believe when you have someone on the ground, oh yes, thank you.
But counsel, before you leave,
oh yes,
where in the record are you looking to support your assertion that the district court found the original video inadmissible? Where did the district court make that ruling?
I don't believe it did.
I don't either.
To be honest with you, it was a little confusing. Part of the decision was a little surprising, but I won't get into all that. But no, I don't think the district court ever found it inadmissible, the unenhanced. I think what the district court seemed to comment on, it had some concerns or issues with whether a proper foundation was laid for the enhancement, and there was some discussion.
But not the original. Okay, that was my question.
Sure. If I can save the rest of my time, if that's okay.
That's fine. Let's hear from the other side, and then you'll have some time.
Okay, thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Nancy Delaney, and I represent the remaining defendant in this action, Officer Soth, who fired the fatal shots when he believed that his sergeant was about to be struck by a baton wielded by the deceased.
So just to make sure on the videotape, as far as you're concerned, the unenhanced video is properly in evidence?
Absolutely.
Okay.
And in fact, we rely on it.
Okay, that's all I want to know. Okay, great. Yeah.
Because the unenhanced video produces the still from Mr. Schott, who is the other expert the defense has. And we agree, as the police practices experts, this is a case where if Officer Soth indeed sees the decedent about to strike his sergeant with a baton, he certainly...
Here's my question. Maybe it's a cluster of questions. We get pretty unambiguous testimony from both of the officers, Ellebrecht and Soth, is that how you pronounce it?
Soth, yes.
That at the time of the first shot, the decedent is standing upright and is swinging, aiming at the head, such that Ellebrecht thought he might even be hit on the top of the head.
Correct.
Now, this apparently happened behind the car.
Correct.
As I look at that videotape, I do see officers standing up, and I can see them. I never see the decedent. So it seems to me, just looking at that videotape, what they say cannot be true because he could not have been standing, otherwise I would see him. So how do you respond to that?
Because where the decedent is standing is on the far right edge.
Wait, the far right edge of what?
Of the video, of what's captured by the car.
That can't be true, because as the video...
You can see both sides of the car.
You can see both sides of the car. Toward the end, the decedent comes out from behind the car. So we know he is behind the car until he goes to the ground and the shots are fired. So he cannot be off the at the edge of the screen.
Actually, that's what the stills show, and that was the problem with the enhanced video.
No, I'm not talking about the enhanced video. I'm talking about the unenhanced video. I looked at both. Frankly, I found the enhanced video much more difficult to see. The unenhanced was easier.
We agree.
Yeah. So, no, I'm talking only about the unenhanced video.
And remember, that's the essence of the ruling by Judge Hamilton below, is the experts relied only on the enhanced video.
But I want to stay on this question of, I get unambiguous testimony from both of the officers that he is standing up, he's swinging at the head, at the time he is shot. That seems to me flatly inconsistent with what I see on the video, because the only time I see him after he comes out from behind the car, he is falling forward. And once he's on the ground, he stays on the ground. So what the officers say is flatly inconsistent with what I saw.
Actually, he's moving forward as he swings.
Well, there's no shot of him swinging. We're clear on that. There's nothing that shows him swinging a baton.
Nothing that shows him swinging. There is the image capture that shows an oblong object in his hand. Well, what it shows is his hand with an oblong object. It can't be identified as a baton, but it's quite a coincidence that an oblong object casts a shadow on the street sign.
Get back to Judge Fletcher's question, because I have the same problem. I've looked at that video any number of times.
Again,
he appears from the video, which you say was admissible into evidence. He appears to be coming out from behind the car. And so my question is still the same one. If he's coming out from behind the car, and the shots are not fired until thereafter as he goes down to the ground, why is there a conflict between that video and the officer's testimony? Not who's telling the truth. There may be evidence the other way, too. I'm just looking to see why there isn't a conflict.
It's because of the angle of the South video, or excuse me, the Ellerbrecht video. And unfortunately, Fortuna was in the process of replacing its car cams, and this was the one that had not yet been replaced. It's a dark, typical Humboldt County, foggy, rainy, and there are artifacts created by that. But as to the perspective, there's no perspective from which that could be captured until he emerges swinging and going forward to the ground from the swing.
Judge Fletcher.
It's the geometry of the scene. And that's what's explained. And again, respectfully, as far as the other issue of the angles and the perspective, the video expert retained by the appellants certainly did not claim that had he been standing, he would have been visible.
Well, it's very clear that had he been standing behind the car, he would have been visible because I can see the officers when they're standing.
And their officer's testimony was that he had raised the baton to a head-high level, which means surely some part of them would have been visible.
Well, the officers say he was standing. They're both on that video at some point.
Actually, when you observe, when the court looks at the problems, and this was offered as a physical exhibit for your honors, the perspective that can be seen of the decedent appears in those because it shows what was cut out of the unenhanced video. And it's just part of his body.
You lost me. Say that again.
We offered documents prepared by Mr. Schott that were before the court and had those physically delivered that show.
Delivered to us? Delivered to the district court?
I believe delivered to this court because there's some.
Is this evidence that was not in front of the district court?
Oh, no, absolutely. It was in front of the district court.
Okay, so. Okay.
This is where Mr. Schott, the true video expert who's been cited favorably by this court because he's a Berkeley mathematician, what he does is.
We don't rely on those Berkeley professors.
been there, done that, okay.
Count the pixels, okay? He can tell you if something's a watermelon or a grape.
Is this the same shot who says that both shots were fired when he was on the ground?
He does not say that both shots were fired when he was on the ground.
That leads to my question. So let's get to that. Maybe you can walk back.
No one says both shots were fired when he was on the ground. What it is.
Doesn't the forensic expert for the other side say both shots entered through the back of Mr. Newmaker?
Correct. Again, which is consistent. And again, we're talking about the geometry of the scene. As we cited to in our authorities, what the forensic expert said was he could be coming up as well as going down. I mean, we're talking about the same.
Fair enough, but if it was coming up when he was shot, then that's not consistent with the officer's testimony that he had a baton and was about to hit Officer Albrecht over the head with it, is it?
That's the first shot, Your Honor.
Well, he says both shots are in the back and are consistent with somebody being shot when on the ground. That's what their forensic expert says. He may be wrong. You may be able to disprove that, but why isn't that enough to get this case to the jury?
Because what the forensic expert actually says is the first, it's consistent with the strike overhead. The angle is the same whether he's going down or coming up. In other words, he doesn't refute the account of the officers.
Now,
the ear witness who's yelling or who's hearing the officer yell, drop the weapon.
No, but I'm confused now. You say it's consistent with him going down. If he's going down, that's a problem for your side. If he's coming up, tell me how he can be coming up consistent with the testimony that the baton has reached head level when we can't see it.
Because he does both. There are two shots. The first shot, he is swinging, and whether, again, it's from being hit by the bullet or his force of forward movement, it's consistent with, and again, the appellant's forensic pathologist acknowledged, it's consistent with him going down and getting back up, as the officers explained.
Yes.
Let me ask you this, if I can. You mentioned the witness. It's Carol Harris.
Correct.
I listened to the video, to the audio recording of that, and at the beginning, the officer conducting the telephone interview says, I'd like to ask you a few more questions, and then really says, what I really need to do is re-interview you. Why don't we have the first interview?
I have no idea. We've produced everything.
No, that's not my question. I'm not accusing you of hiding something. I'm asking you. It's very clear from the introduction when he starts to talk to Ms. Harris on the telephone. He says, I need to ask you a few more questions. I need to do another interview. Obviously, then, there was a previous interview. Why don't we have it?
I assume we do have it, Your Honor, and that it was produced to plaintiffs. Plaintiffs, I know, scheduled the deposition.
So you're telling me that the plaintiffs have an earlier interview with Ms. Harris?
They may well have, Your Honor. They scheduled her deposition and then canceled it. That's why we produced the declaration.
with you, but you maybe you just don't know the answer. But it puzzled me severely to have an audio tape of a telephone interview that refers very clearly to an earlier interview, and this is a re-interview. Well, I would love to read or to read a copy of or hear that first interview.
But you're telling us it's not in the record?
Not
whether or not you produced it, it's not in the record on appeal.
Not to my knowledge, Your Honor. Again, prior to the time the motions were due, the plaintiffs were going to depose Ms. Harris. And for reasons unknown to the defense, they canceled that deposition. We then obtained a declaration just to put before the court what we thought were the key elements to which she could swear under oath. Admittedly, she didn't see the baton.
Well, but of course, the reason I'm interested in this is that she says very clearly and several times that she heard one of the officers say, drop the weapon.
Absolutely.
And if at the time that she's hearing this, the decedent is holding and swinging the weapons, that's obviously very powerful evidence in favor of your side of the case. So I'm trying to figure out, well, you know, testimony changes over time. I'd like to know what you might have said earlier. But I'd also like to compare that to what Officer Soth says in his deposition, where he's asked, do you remember saying drop the weapon after he was shot? And he says, yes. Do you remember saying drop the weapon before he was shot? And he says, no. So the question would then be, well, what's the sequence of the drop the weapon statement or command and the shooting? Because even if it's true that she's recollecting properly, and she's clearly a disinterested witness, that she heard drop the weapon, the question then may be, okay, well, at what point in the sequence did she hear it? So, I mean, I've got problems with the testimony, but I sure would like to see some earlier interview because I know there was one.
Well, and again, Your Honor, the evidence before the trial court was indeed the declaration, and certainly if there was anything inconsistent that she said at any other time or anything she recollected differently, there was an opportunity to explore that.
This is not a charge at all to counsel, but it's curious that a police department would have record of a second interview without a record of the first interview.
That may well be the district attorney's office, Your Honor. Again, it's not the city of Fortuna.
It may be the police force.
Since I think you can't answer that question, let me ask you one that I think you can answer. How long is it between the first and second shots, according to the video?
The best estimate by Mr. Soth is approximately 2 seconds. The video, there is...
flashes. Yes. But the video, they seem to be closer together than that if one tracks it through. Do you agree with that?
There's no basis to disagree, Your Honor. As with all of the opposition to the summary judgment, it would be rank speculation. We submit the only probative evidence produced in the district court shows that Officer Soth fired his weapon because the oblong object that we see against the street sign was a baton in the hand of Mr. Newmaker that necessitated.
Is there anything probative that comes out of the geometry, if you will, of the entrance wounds, at the entrance of the bullets into the victim in this case, with respect to how quickly the shots were fired? In other words, would there have been time? There seems to be some inference on the other side that he was hit once when going down and hit twice on the ground. I'm sorry. Can we tell anything from how quickly the shots were fired from your view of the case? Even taking 2 seconds.
No, Your Honor. What we can tell is that one of the bullets, and again, both forensic pathologists indicate they can't really tell which was the first,
but certainly it allows for Mr. Newmaker to begin to rise again. There's no forensic evidence that there was a bullet strike, for example, to the spine that incapacitated
him. Right, so let me ask you that. If he began to rise again, is what you think happened is that he was shot while standing, went down to the ground, began to rise again, and was shot?
Well, Your Honor, standing is somewhat ambiguous.
Right, but he was on his 2 feet.
Perhaps, but not again standing erect.
No, I understand.
Well, but if he's doing that, Ellenbrink's head is pretty close to the ground.
And so the baton would not be visible above the car.
Correct.
So, but just, there's all kinds of issues here.
Well, and Ellenbrink, again, is affected by pepper spray, so that's part of the problem.
But stick with my question for a second, because it puzzles me. If he was on his feet the first time he was swinging the baton, Mr. Newmaker, and then the theory about the second one was that he was rising again, if you will, correct?
That was the perception.
That was the perception. Could that happen in 2 seconds? Could one be shot, go to the ground, and then get up and be rising again in 2 seconds? Now, I think it's 1 second when I look at the film, but yeah, let me give you the two.
Well, and again,
1001, 1002.
Either way, 1001, it's all fluid as far as the perception of the officers. That's why she had the split-second decision and perception.
But the real question is whether the officers are telling the truth. I mean, that's the problem.
Well, but again, Your Honor, we're certainly mindful of they said and he's dead case law, but that's not what we have here. Here we have Carol Harris. We have a video image of the baton.
We have Carol Harris saying she hears drop the weapon, but we have Officer Soth, who's the shooter, who says, yeah, I remember telling him drop the weapon after I shot him. So that's not inconsistent.
But what he's saying is what he can remember. He's not saying I didn't tell him drop.
No, I get that.
And again, the sequence that Carol Harris gives us is she hears him telling and yelling, and it only makes sense, drop the weapon before she hears the shot.
Officer Soth does say, I shot him first, and then he was starting to rise up again, and I shot him again, correct?
Right. So there definitely is a time after he shoots him that, again, he's saying drop
the weapon. Right. Well, put aside drop the weapon for a second. I'm just trying to. You know, Officer Soth says, I shot him twice. Once when his feet were on the ground, if you will. Right? Put aside whether he was parallel or oblique to the ground. And another time when he tried to get up. It's correct?
Correct.
And I think that if the video shows that it was 2 seconds between those two intervals, my question was, between the two shots, doesn't that cast significant doubt on Officer Soth's version of the events? It's just very hard for me to believe that someone can be hit with a round, fall to the ground, and start to get up again all within 2 seconds. That's the question I was trying to ask. Put aside who was yelling what, who said what.
But again, Your Honor, it's not falling to the ground, hit with a round. It's also, there's the toxicology is before the court. He has methamphetamine on board.
He hopped up on everything in the world. That's still my question.
And
is it possible to do all that within the range of 2 seconds?
There's certainly no evidence before the trial court that that's not possible. And that was not ever the matter of any evidentiary dispute. And again, the thing with the videos and the problem with the expert reports and the reason excluded by Judge Hamilton is because if we come in here and take a video of the back of the room and give that to an expert, and the expert says, none of the justices appeared today. I have a video that shows the courtroom, and none of them are sitting. Well, that's because that's not what's being captured by the video.
This is a little bit off point, but it brings to mind Judge Hamilton's disqualifying the expert report on the ground that the expert relied for his conclusion on the enhanced video. I don't read the expert report that way. The expert report says, I reviewed, and then he gives a list of what he reviewed. At the top of that list is the unenhanced video. Do you agree that that's what he says?
That's, again, we offered.
Do you agree that that's what he says in his declaration? That he says, I reviewed, and pretty much the top of that list is the unenhanced video.
Your Honor, I don't recall the declaration per se, but that's not what he said in his deposition. And that's why that was the subject of the expert
deposition. So it's the deposition you rely on at that point. Okay, I got it.
Well, he admitted what he's relying on is the enhanced video, and he admitted that he had no expertise with interpreting or analyzing video.
Okay, so it's the deposition that Judge Hamilton is relying on, which he says critical to his conclusion was the enhanced video.
That's
your
what
position.
We offered by way of evidence, yes. And it was, again.
Okay, no, I get it. Okay. Any further questions from the bench? Okay, we've taken you over. Thank you.
Thank you.
Response.
Yes, I don't believe, to my recollection, but I have to double check this, that there was any deposition testimony of Dr. O'Halloran included in the motion for summary judgment. My impression was similar to you, that I couldn't understand how the judge would not have considered that, because he clearly said he relied on a lot of things, including the unenhanced video autopsy report. To get to the issue of the judge, I think one interpretation of that video is that the two shots happened within a second. But I think even more importantly is the two shots, both to lower back, both have a 30-degree upward trajectory, both of them, 30-degree upward trajectory, both consistent with his position on the ground when the shots happened. What would be the chances, not only of him getting from up to down and up again within 1 second, but having both shots with exactly the same 30-degree upward trajectory? I would suggest the chances are not very high. I also think, in terms of the credibility, which I think is very important, and it's been part of this discussion, the officer's original statements were, we shot him two times while he was standing upright, swinging the baton at the officer's head. Then he went to the ground. No threat while he was on the ground, no getting up, no baton, no striking, nothing when he was on the ground. By the time of their deposition, they said one of the shots happened when he was on the ground, because I think a reasonable inference, someone realizes you can see muzzle flash, but by the time of the experts, both shots happened while he was on the ground, and I think at a minimum, a reasonable inference from all the evidence is that both shots happened while he was on the ground. And once you get there, for purposes of this motion, the motion for summary judgment should have been denied. Qualified immunity should have been denied. And obviously, we're asking this court to send this back, to reinstate the state claims, if this court can do that, because we refiled in state court not knowing what was going to happen because she refused to exercise pendant jurisdiction over the state claims.
It may well be on remand, however, that the district judge could still decline to exercise pendant jurisdiction.
That would be helpful.
We could just reverse the order and send it back to her.
The one other thing, if I have time, I'm looking at 10 seconds, so I'll try.
Well, we took the other side over. Thank you, Robert.
I do. A couple of the other credibility issues to consider in addition with Officer Soap. He said that he only used two or three baton strikes. We believe a careful review of the video shows four or five on the side of the car and possibly one, and I'll be honest with you, I didn't catch it until I kept looking at it behind the car. He said he never shot, in this testimony that we cited, he never shot at the decedent's back, which we find interesting because it's undisputed we have two shots to the back. I think I already mentioned, you touched on the drop the weapon sequence and the discrepancy between him and Sergeant Ellibrecht about whether anybody moved that baton to the other side of the street.
And you may not know any more than the other side did. As to any prior interview with the witness, Carol Harris?
I don't recall, Your Honor. I think that was a good, from your perspective, I think that was a, you obviously saw them reviewing to another interview. So whether we ever received it or not, I cannot say with certainty. I asked my associate, we're not sure. The last thing I'd like to address was, the other things that make this case sad. You have someone who's naked from the waist down. According to the officers, never punched, never kicked, never verbally threatened. Obviously had something going on where he needed help. It makes it particularly sad. But the baton strikes that happened before by Soth, one of the issues that we had was whether those might have been excessive. It appears on the video that he's more or less, there might have been some resistance going on perhaps, but he doesn't look like he's being assaultive with the officers.
And well, in terms of the video, we see that's correct. We have no idea what happened between the time we see on Officer Soth's video chasing this man on the bicycle.
That's true.
Fully clothed. And the time we see Officer Ellibrecht's video picking up, he's on the ground, armed with a T-shirt, naked from the waist down, being hit with a baton. There obviously was a struggle. We know there was one in which he lost his pants. There's something happened in the intervening period in which there was some sort of a conflict.
That is true. But at least from even Officer Soth says there's no punch, kick, or verbal threat in at least the portion of the video that we could see. I think it might be an issue of fact. So unless there's any other questions from any of you, I thank you all. And you obviously looked at this very carefully, so we really appreciate that.
Well, thank both sides for your helpful arguments. Newmaker versus City of Fortuna now submitted for decision, and we're adjourned.